bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for a beautiful day today where we can gather together in peace and safety, Lord, still in the building that you provided for us, Lord, to the name of our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the grace that's provided for us, your faithfulness, Lord, that's unwavering, and your mercy that's renewed every day, where we can pray to you, Father. We know you hear our prayers, Lord, and we know with faith you answer our prayers, Father. We just pray for the service tonight. Pray for Pastor John as he brings forth your message. Pray you would just bless him, Lord, and continue to speak through the Spirit through him, Lord, that it would minister to us, Lord, that we could grow and draw closer to you and become better disciples of your Son, Jesus, Lord. We pray for our hearts, Lord, that it be open to hear the message. Pray that we'd be attentive, Lord, and eager to hear, Lord, and ready to listen. We pray for the family of our sister Norma, Lord. Pray you would just comfort their hearts, Lord, and just give them peace, Lord, knowing that she was a believer and she is in heaven with you today, Father. And pray you would just comfort their hearts and just continue to give them peace, Father, and we lift them up before you. We pray that you would bless all that we do tonight, that it would bring glory and honor to your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. If we could stand and praise the Lord.
Never cease to This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day.
Be seated. Tonight's announcements. Tomorrow night at 7 p.m. in the fellowship hall is Pastor's Prayer and Praise Night. I encourage all you guys to come out. God is a God who answers prayers. Amen. Friday, May 4th. This Friday is Pastor's Evangelism class in the fellowship hall as well at 7 p.m. Once again, you're all invited to come out. And this Sunday is the Lord's Supper. Come with your hearts prepared. And We just ask that you continue to pray for our sister Norma's family. As some of you know, Norma had recently passed away this past Saturday, and we will have all the specifics on the arrangements by this weekend. So just be patient and we'll have all the information for you. With that said, now it's my honor and privilege tonight to introduce our pastor, Pastor John Ritchie.
How's everybody doing tonight? I'm going to take your Bible, and I'd like you to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're going to begin in verse 17, but I'd like to have a word of prayer first. If we could have a word of prayer, if we could bow our heads. Go before the Lord. Father, tonight we're grateful and thankful once again to have this time and this opportunity, Lord, to gather together with the people of God around the Word of God and to the name of our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, tonight I pray that you would challenge our hearts to continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ as we study these important truths and principles from your Word. Pray you meet each one of us at our point of need, Lord. Give us what we need tonight, Lord, to keep growing. And I pray that I could speak with wisdom, with grace, with conviction, with passion, with the authority that your word deserves. And I ask that I could take the knowledge that you've given me on this subject, make it clear and accurate and simple and understandable that your people may be blessed. And if there be anyone within the sound of my voice tonight, Lord, or in the future that hears this message and they're not saved, my prayer is that you would convict them of their sin and of their need of Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they might believe upon him and receive the forgiveness of sins and eternal life through faith in his name. And we ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. I'd like you to turn to 2 Corinthians 5. We're going to begin there this evening, but by way of quick review, let's look over. We've been looking at the Holy Spirit, the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit, and the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit for God's people, for believers. Mike, we're going to go with the first principle first. We can put that up. And the first point that we want to make is we said that the first thing that the Holy Spirit does for the believer is regenerates them. And we said regeneration is the creative act of God whereby he imparts eternal life to the dead human spirit of the believer. We are born physically alive and spiritually dead without the life of God in us. Hence the need for regeneration, which is the new spiritual birth. By believing in Christ, the Holy Spirit comes and regenerates the believer. He puts eternal life within the believer, and now the believer is not only physically alive, but is also spiritually alive and possesses eternal life. That's what it means to be born again. Second point, what the Holy Spirit does for the believer, our second point is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit takes up residence in the believer. The Holy Spirit, the moment that we believe in Christ, comes to live inside of us, to be our guide, our comforter, our teacher, and to empower us to live the Christian life as we learn the Word of God and walk by faith. The third thing that the Holy Spirit does, he regenerates, he indwells, is he baptizes the believer. The believer is baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ. The believer is made part of the body of Christ, part of Christ himself. The believer is now in Christ. Baptized by the Spirit, to be baptized means to be totally identified with something or someone. The connotation of immersing something into another environment with no thought of removal. It is the introduction or placement of a person or thing into a new environment or into union with something else so as to alter the condition or its relationship to its previous environment. You say, what does that mean, Pastor? It means this. You were born in Adam, a condemned sinner, unrighteous, with a debt of sin, spiritually dead. That was your condition before you came to believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior. You were under the condemnation of God. The moment you believed in Christ, the Holy Spirit regenerated you and gave you eternal life. He indwelt you and he baptized you, or he immersed you, or totally identified you with who? The person of Jesus Christ, in such a way that it altered your previous environment. Your previous environment before you believed in Jesus Christ was you were in Adam. But when you believed in Christ, the Spirit took you out of Adam and he placed you where? In Christ. And you now have no longer any attachment to that previous environment. You are out of Adam forever. Now you are justified, righteous, forgiven, spiritually alive, born again, and no longer condemned, and that is your permanent position. Your condition has been altered forever. You are now in Christ. This is what the baptism of the Holy Spirit accomplishes. And we said, of course, there's a lot of confusion about that. Churches that tell you, you know, after you get saved, you have to pray and tarry and wait and have some experience, and then you'll get baptized by the Spirit. That's simply not true. The moment you believe in Christ, you are made part of Christ. You are part of his body. You are totally identified with him, but identified with him so drastically that your previous environment or position in Adam has now been altered and changed forever. You're no longer identified with Adam. You are now forever identified with who? Christ, in everything that he is. And praise God for that. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17, because tonight what I want to do is look at what is this position in Christ? What are some of the things that are true of us as believers because we are now in Christ? Now, before I get into this, just want to make one more point. When we say position in Christ, we're talking about who we are in our standing before God, how God sees us as believers. We're not talking about our walk down here on earth. We're talking about our standing or our position before God, how he, as the judge of the universe, sees us. And when we say position in Christ, we're talking about how God sees the believer always in Christ. When he sees us, he sees Christ. Now, we know down on earth, we fail to live like Christ many times, daily, right? But that does not change our new position. You see? Because we've been totally immersed into Christ, identified with him, so that our previous environment in Adam is what? Done away with. And we're now totally identified with Christ. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and let's look at verse 17. Paul writes, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ," you see it? In Christ. And how do you get in Christ? Do you get in Christ by getting baptized in water? No. Do you get in Christ by joining the church? No. Do you get in Christ by confessing your sins? No. Do you get in Christ by getting sacraments from a priest? No. Do you get in Christ by turning over a new leaf and living a reformed holy life? No. You get in Christ one way and one way only, by believing in him as your Savior. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. The moment you believe in Christ, you are now baptized by the Spirit into Christ. It is a free gift that is part of the riches of God's grace. You didn't earn this position. It was given to you freely. Praise God. We ought to be so happy about that, right? And it says here, if any man be in Christ, this new position, this new environment, I'm no longer identified with Adam over here and all the condemnation and guilt and spiritual death and ruin and the debt that I owe to the law, that's gone. I'm over here in Christ now. No longer condemned, declared righteous, forgiven of all my sins, a standing in grace, spiritually alive with the very what? Life of God. Identified in Jesus, okay? And it says, if we're in Christ, he's a what? A new creature. What's the new creature? That means being born again. Being born again is a creative act of God whereby he comes and he puts his spirit, his life, eternal life, inside the believer in such a way, it's a creative act that we now become a new creature. In this old body of sinful flesh, there lives a new creature. See? We've been born again. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Now it says, old things are passed away. Now people get confused about that. They think the old things, and we've all heard plenty of preachers say this, old things are passed away. You don't drink no more. You don't steal no more. You don't lie no more. You don't sin no more. No. Well, we hope you don't do all those things, but you may, okay? You got to grow. When he says old things are passed away, he means who you were in what? Adam. Your old condition, your old position has now been what? Changed and transformed. You are no longer identified with old Adam and all the ruin and condemnation that was brought about by Adam's sin, which you inherited. You are now leaving the old, I've left old Adam behind 39 years ago when I trusted Christ. And we're now over here in Christ, a new creature. God doesn't see us in the guilt and condemnation of Adam anymore. He sees us in the righteousness and the grace of God in Christ. Are you with me so far? And it says, old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become what? New. What's the all things? Who I am now in Christ. I have this new identity. And if you're going to grow as a Christian, you have to begin to believe these truths that are set forth about your position, which really there are not many churches that are preaching the truth about the believer's position in Christ today. It's all about what you must do for God, you know? The truth of the matter is, the moment we believed, we were given a whole new position before God, a whole new standing. We're no longer identified with Adam and his sin and his ruin and his guilt and his condemnation. We're now totally identified with Christ and his righteousness. All things have become new. And we've been given tremendous new positions. Now, we're going to look at some of the things that are true of us tonight because of our new position in Christ, which is ours forever. And I just want to mention, so that we'll understand, a few things that we need to understand. When we're talking about position, we're talking about how God sees us. We're talking about our legal standing before God, which is a gift of God's grace. When we talk about our walk or our experience or our state on earth, we're talking about what's going on in our lives down here, right? On earth. But no matter what's going on in my life down here on earth, whether I'm doing good or doing poorly spiritually, my standing remains the same. You understand? And that is the basis of my eternal acceptance before God, and that's how God sees me forever. I'm part of Christ. Remember last week, at the end of our study, we saw how Jesus said, "And Father, that thou hast loved them as thou hast loved what? Me." Meaning that God the Father loves believers as much as he loves who? Jesus. How could that be? We're not Jesus. We can understand how he could love Jesus. He's sinless and perfect and holy. Right? He loves us as much as he loves Jesus because we are what? In Christ. We're part of Christ. We're totally identified with Christ. And Christ has become our position before the Father. This is an amazing truth. Okay, the first thing I want to know, we're just going to go quickly, is this. These positions are invisible. You say, what do you mean by that, Pastor? These positions that we're going to talk about, they're real, but we don't see them, okay? They're real, they're true, but we don't see them. They're invisible. But let me show you a verse in 2 Corinthians 4. I want you to go to verse 18. I want you to note something about this. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 18 says, "While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, the invisible things. For the things which are seen are temporal. They're just temporary. But the things which are not seen are what? Eternal. So we're looking at invisible truths that are true about us as Christians that we can't see right now with our physical eyes. But they're real and they're true right now, and they are permanent. They're not what? Temporal or temporary. They're eternal. The second thing, not only is it, are they invisible, but they are real. They are unexperienced. You say, what do you mean by that? Well, we don't experience them physically. Okay? I am the perfect righteousness of God in my position in Christ. Do I experience that perfect righteousness in my walk on earth? I'm far from it. So are you. We sin, thought, word, and deed. So I don't experience perfect righteousness down here, but my position is I am in a perfect righteous standing before God because I'm in Christ. So these positions are invisible and they're unexperienced. Third thing, these positions are known and apprehended or understood by faith. You can only know these positions because the Bible what? Declares them to be true of us. And now for them to bring peace in our heart and blessing, we have to believe them, right? If you want to keep believing that you're a no good, bum, rotten sinner in Adam, then that's what you're going to feel like. You have to learn to believe that the old man, the old position in Adam has passed away. You've been baptized by the Spirit into Christ. You're a new creature. You're forgiven. You're declared righteous. You're accepted by God forever. You're born again and spiritually alive. You're a son of God permanently. You're forgiven perfectly. And that's never going to change. So they're invisible, they're unexperienced, and they are known or understood or apprehended by what? Faith. And here's the thing. If we will believe the truths that are declared, and we're going to study them, if we will believe these truths declared in the Bible, which are real yet invisible to us, it will lead us to the experience of peace, joy, and confidence. Because we will understand that even though I still sin and stumble, it doesn't change my position before who? God, because of what Christ did for me at the cross. And because now he has baptized me by his Spirit into this whole new position. And if I believe what the Bible declares, then I will realize, wow, I am in a perfect, permanent, eternal relationship with God who loves and accepts me forever, even though on this earth I still bumble and stumble. That will lead to what? Peace, confidence, and joy. If I believe it, I got to believe it. By what? Faith. Fourth thing, very important. These positions will be contested. You say, what does that mean? Satan wants to keep you ignorant of these positions. And I would say he's done a pretty good job of it. Anybody been in churches where people were ignorant of these positions? Can I have a show of hands? Anybody ever been in a... Come on, it'd be more than that. I think everybody here has. Don't be shy. Raise your hand. I'm not going to bite you. All right? We've all been in churches where the preaching was all about what you must do for God and how you're such a rotten, filthy sinner and you got to live up to this standard and you know you haven't and you can't and you won't ever. Right? And you just feel worse. When you leave church, you feel worse than when you went. Right? But the truth of the matter is, why is that happening? Because Satan keeps pastors and preachers and teachers and the Christians in the what? Congregation, the pews, ignorant of these great truths that are declared in Scripture of our position exalted in Christ. We're said to be seated in heavenly places in Christ, Ephesians 2:6. And it's a shame because churches where this great truths are, and doctrines are not taught, the people stay at a very low level of spirituality. And it's sad. But Satan will contest them. And listen, Satan will love the next time you sin and fail and fall flat on your face to come out and get his big spiritual bat and beat you up with condemnation. and guilt and make you feel lousy about yourself. But if you know your position in Christ, you're going to say, yep, I just blew it, but you know what? Thank God, let me get up, dust off the dirt that I was just in. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. Thank you for this position that I have. Thank you that you accept me in Christ and keep going. See? By his what? Grace. You've got to learn to do that because Satan will challenge these positions in your what? Mind. Will you believe what God says about yourself even when you know, boy, I don't live up to that? Guess what? You never live up to it. It has been given to us by a what? Gift of grace. All right, another one. They're unmerited. That's pretty simple. Everything we said right up to this point makes us realize that. Unmerited means we did nothing to deserve them. They're unmerited. We did nothing to deserve these positions. These positions are not earned by how good we are. They are a gift of what? God's grace, the riches of his grace. The sixth thing, there's seven things here, one for each day of the week. The sixth thing, unchangeable. These positions are unchangeable. You know, once we have believed in Christ and we've been placed in Christ and baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ, we have an unchangeable position. In other words, our performance never affects our standing before God in Christ. I can have the lousiest experience of a Christian on the face of the earth that doesn't change the fact that I'm in Christ, saved and accepted forever, no longer condemned, totally forgiven. You understand that? They're unchangeable. Let me show you a verse. Go with me to 1 John. Go to the back of the New Testament. Right before the book of Revelation, you'll see the little epistle of 1 John. And when you get to 1 John, I want you to go to chapter 4. And we're going to look at verse 17. These positions are invisible. They're unexperienced. They're apprehended by faith. They will be contested by Satan. They're unmerited. We don't earn them. And they are unchangeable. They are unchangeable. They never change. Our performance does not affect our position. That's why we're secure in our salvation forever. We are part of Christ. The day that the Father no longer accepts Jesus, that's the day you're going to hell. The day Jesus goes to hell is the day you're going to hell. Do you realize how secure a position you are in today? Folks, we don't, like I said, this is invisible and unexperienced to us down here, but one day when we stand in his presence, we're going to understand it all. We'll say, oh, gee, that's what you meant, Lord. Now I see. Right? But let's believe it now and enter into what? The peace and the confidence and the joy of our relationship and acceptance with God. Do you ever have a day where you just know you were a miserable example of a Christian? I've had a lot of days like that. Right? Some of them recently, by the way. Right? But you know what? The great truth is, didn't stop me from going forward. Used to, when I didn't understand these truths. Don't stop me from going forward. Hey, I'm getting up. Guess what? I know who I am in Christ, and I'm just going to keep plowing ahead, Lord. Know you got something good for me. You're just going to keep trusting. You're going to keep standing on who I am in Christ. Not going to make excuses for my failures. I'm going to learn from them. But I'm not going to dwell on them. I know who I am in Christ. Are you with me now? Okay. They're unchangeable. Look what it says. Verse 17. You got it? 1 John chapter 4. Herein is our love made perfect or complete, mature, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. We can have a mature understanding of God's love for us. So much so that we can be bold and know that when we stand before God, we're going to be received into his what? Kingdom forever. Totally confident. No doubt. Because look, why? Look at the last part of that verse. Because as he is, and that's a reference to who? Christ. So are we in this world. You say, what does that mean? As he is. Who and what
Jesus Christ is, as he's seated at the right hand of the Father, is who you and I are in this world. Is Christ perfectly accepted by the Father? Is he perfectly loved by the Father? Is he perfectly righteous and holy and blameless before the Father? Yes. Will this be forever? Absolutely. Will it ever change? No, never. That's who you are as a child of God, even though you're in this world. You are in Christ. As he is, so are we in this world. We're down here, he's up there, but just as he is before the Father, and all that he is to the Father, and all that the Father is to him, that's true of who? Me and you, if you have believed in Jesus Christ, no matter how weak or struggling a Christian you may be. Do you hear me? As he is, so are we in this world. He is my standing. Can't get better than that. You can't improve on perfection, can you? You can't, right? He is my perfect standing before God. You got to believe it, folks. One more thing, and then we'll look at some of this. These positions are eternal. That's our seventh point. Go to Hebrews 7. Hebrews chapter 7, look at verse 25. These positions are eternal. They are permanent. You say, how long will these positions last? Forever. As long as the eternal life of God, as long as the eternal life of Jesus Christ. That's how long this position will last. It's permanent, it's forever, it's eternal. Hebrews 7:25 says of Christ, wherefore he, Jesus, is able also to save them to the uttermost. And to be saved to the uttermost means forever, to the very extremities, to the farthest reaches that you could possibly think. Basically forever. He is able to save to the uttermost forever that come unto God by him. Why? Seeing he ever liveth to make it intercession for them. He ever lives to pray for what? Us. So these positions are what? Eternal and permanent. Okay, let's look at some of these things tonight. Let's look at some of the things that the Scripture declares to be true of us tonight. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to look at verse number 21. One of the amazing things that's true of my position in Christ. If you got 2 Corinthians, I want you to go to chapter 5, and we'll read verse 21. Position in Christ. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things pass away, no longer identified with who? Adam. Totally identified with who? Christ, his new position. Possessing the eternal life of God. Old things pass away. All things have become what? New. We have become, here's the first position we want to note, which we should be familiar with. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. We have been made the righteousness of God in Christ. It's not something we earned. It's not something we merited. We didn't do anything to become this righteousness. It was given to us as a free gift. You see, to get into God's kingdom, to get into heaven, to have a relationship with him, you have to be as righteous as he is. And guess what? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and the glory of God is the righteousness of God. We've all sinned and fallen short of the righteousness of God. So if we're going to get into heaven, we need the righteousness of God, but we can't do it on our own because we've sinned. So God provided a righteousness for us that has nothing to do with our own works or performance. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21. For he, that's God the Father, hath made him, that's Jesus the Son, to be sin for us, to be the sin offering. Okay?
who knew no sin, that's Christ's sinlessness, which qualified him to become the Redeemer, that we might be, note it says, made the righteousness of God, where? In him. Do you see what it says? We have been made the righteousness of God in him. The moment you believed in Jesus Christ, you know what God pronounced on your life? He took you out of Adam, the old things, the old position. He put you in Christ by the baptism of the Spirit. And then he said, I, as the judge of the Supreme Court of heaven, the sovereign authority of the universe, I declare you as a believer the righteousness of God. As righteous as my son Jesus. This is what we call an alien righteousness, meaning that it's a righteousness that has nothing to do with our performance. It's alien to us. It's foreign to us. It is given to us as a gift by the justice of God the moment we believe in Christ, because he satisfied the demands of God's righteousness at the cross. So you have been declared the righteousness of God tonight. Do you experience that on earth? No. Do you see that? No. But it's nevertheless what? True of you, and will be true forever of you as a believer in Jesus Christ. Are you with me here so far? Okay. Look at Romans. Flip back to Romans. I'll demonstrate this a little more to you. Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, I want you to look at verse number 22. Actually, let's read verses 20, 21, and 22, right? It says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Now, to be justified means to be declared what? Righteous. To be justified means to be declared righteous. So by the deeds of the law, no flesh can be justified in God's sight. In other words, no one can be declared righteous by following laws, by their own works, or by their own performance. You get all these folks in religious circles today, all kinds of denominations. Their salvation plan is believe in Jesus and live a holy life, and they'll get to heaven. That'll split hell wide open. It's believe in Jesus and him what? Alone. It's not Jesus plus your righteousness. It's Jesus and his righteousness and nothing else. And it says, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. The law was given not as a means of salvation. The law was given to show us what sin was so that we would realize that we're sinners and that we would look for a what? Savior. Since we couldn't keep the law, we couldn't save ourselves, we need someone else to save us. Verse 21, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Now notice what it says. There's a righteousness that comes from God. It's called the righteousness of God that has nothing to do with what? The law. There's a righteousness which God has provided which has nothing to do with keeping laws, human performance, works, religion, rituals, etc. is a righteousness that has nothing to do with keeping laws or meriting it or doing good or living holy. And then it was witnessed by the law of the Old Testament and the prophets in the sense that they prophesied Christ's coming, who provided this righteousness. And then look at verse 22. Even the righteousness of who? God. Which is by faith of Jesus Christ. It's a righteousness God has provided unto all. It's offered to everybody and upon all them that believe. It's offered to everybody. It comes upon those who actually what? Believe. The only ones who possess this righteousness are those who believe in Jesus Christ. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So as believers, we have been declared the righteousness of God. We have received this righteousness which is from God that has nothing to do with the law, or works. If you look at verse 24, this righteousness means that we are what? Justified. We are given a righteous standing legally before God. It's a legal declaration. When God justifies you, it means you've been in court, he's examined your case, your life, and he's declared you what? Not just forgiven, but totally righteous, as if you never sinned, with the righteousness of Jesus. You starting to get the picture here? Look at what it says, verse 24. Being justified, because we were given this righteousness, here's what happened. The justice of God was free to impart the righteousness to us the moment we believed, because Christ satisfied God's demands at the cross. So the justice of God is now free to impute the righteousness. The justice of God imputes the righteousness to the believer. And then God turns around and says, because you have my righteousness, you are now justified forever. You get the picture? This is something God does for every believer. Being justified freely by his what? Grace. It comes to us freely because of God's grace, his unmerited favor, everything that God is free to do for the believer because of what Christ did at the cross. And it says, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Go with me to Romans 5. So, the first thing that we note about this new position, we are the righteousness of God. Second thing we note, we've been declared justified. Means we've been given a legal standing of righteousness before God. We've been in court. The judge heard our case. And he what? He said, he banged the gavel and he said, I declare you righteous. As if you never sinned. Not just forgiven, but totally righteous. Third thing we want to note, righteousness of God, justified, we have peace with God. Look at verse 1. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, not by our works, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have peace with God. Because we have been given this legal standing of righteousness, be given this imputed righteousness, we have this legal standing of justification, and now because we have this standing of justification, we have peace with God. What does that mean? God is not angry at us for our sins any longer. You realize today, if you will leave here tonight and sin and do wrong, do you realize that God is not angry with you? His spirit can be grieved because he wants better for you, but he can never, ever, ever be angry. He's not at war with you for your sins anymore. You have peace with God. God is not holding your sins against you. Peace with God. Do you get it? We have peace with God. There's nothing between him and I. There's nothing between me and God tonight. It's been that way for 39 years. It'll be that way forever. Same for you if you've believed in Jesus as your Savior. Let's move on. Let's go to Ephesians, if you will, chapter 1. Just take Romans. You'll find 1st and 2nd Corinthians, then Galatians. And right after Galatians, you'll find Ephesians. Go to Ephesians chapter 1. The righteousness of God, justified, legal standing, peace with God. God is not at war with you because of your sins and failures. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Look at verses 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. There's that phrase again, in Christ. Now, what we're talking about tonight is part of these spiritual blessings. You say, what's all this spiritual blessings in heavenly places? Well, we just talked about three of them. You're the righteousness of God, your legal standing is justified, and you have peace with God. and what's going to be said. And the other things, what we're saying tonight, when you read that verse that says you've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ because you're what? In Christ. These blessings are yours because you're in Christ and you're not in Adam anymore. These are the blessings. You are the righteousness of God. Your legal standing is justified forever. You have peace with God. He's not holding anything against you. And look here at verse 4. Look what it says. According as he had chosen us in him, nobody's chosen outside of Christ and placed in Christ. You're not part of the elect or the chosen until you're in Christ. Before the foundation of the world, God chose Christ before the foundation of the world, and God chooses to bless everyone who ever will be in Christ with these spiritual blessings. Keep reading. That we should be holy and without blame before him in what? Love. So here's our fourth, the fourth thing that's true of our position. God says, as a believer, you are holy and without blame. Is that a reference to your daily walk, your state? No, there's a lot of things he could blame us for, right? But our standing before him is what? Holy, without blame. Why? We're in Christ. We're part of Christ. We're made part of his body by the baptism of the Spirit. Therefore, he sees us as he sees who? Christ. Let's move forward. Go with me to Romans chapter 6. Go back to Romans. Romans chapter 6. We'll look at a couple more of these tonight before we close. We'll pick up with this in our next study. The righteousness of God, justified, legal standing, peace with God, holy and blameless because we're in Christ. The next one, we are not under the law, but under what? Grace. You go into some churches today and all you will hear is a list of rules preached at people that if you're a Christian, you got to do this, 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 and that. Now, we talked about Sunday, because we are Christians, God wants us to live a certain way, but not to earn his acceptance. We want to live right so we can honor him and glorify him and receive his highest and best. But whether we live right or we live wrong, it doesn't change our what? Position. It doesn't change our position. You see? And what you get in most churches is a steady diet of what you must do for God, what you must do for God, what you must call it legalism, which is basically you need to do this for God if you're going to be what? Accepted by him and be saved. And that's simply another gospel. Paul calls it a perversion of the gospel. We're saved by faith alone, in Christ alone. We cannot earn God's forgiveness or acceptance. We cannot earn these positions. We cannot make ourselves the righteousness of God. He makes us the righteousness of God. And the great news is this. Look at Romans chapter 6, verse 14. Part of my position is that the law no longer has jurisdiction over me. Do you realize that the law of God cannot condemn you tonight? And do you know why? We'll see that in another verse in a moment. Because Christ took the curse of the law. And there's no double jeopardy. If Christ suffered for you, then you can never suffer the curse of the law. Look at Romans 6, 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under what? Grace. There's only two places you can be in the Christian life. You can be living under the law, trying to what? Earn God's acceptance, earn his favor, earn heaven by what? Keeping a bunch of rules and taboos and do's and don'ts and a lot of man-made traditions, right? And that's called being under what? The law. Or you can be out from under the law in Christ and be under what? Grace. And to be under grace means you have no obligation to keep the law to earn God's acceptance. We try to live holy and live right not to earn God's acceptance, but because we have already been accepted. And there's a big difference. We live right because we have been accepted. We don't live right to earn acceptance. You get the picture here? Go with me to Galatians. If you got Romans, just go again, 1 Corinthians, then 2 Corinthians, and then you'll find Galatians. When you get to Galatians, go to chapter 3. The position of the believer in Christ is we have been removed from any obligation to the law forever. That's why legalism is such a terrible curse upon the church today. Legalism is a terrible curse. So many Christians have been brought into bondage by legalistic preachers and legalistic teaching that tells them that to be accepted by God and to get to heaven and to be a good Christian, you have to do this, 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 and that. And then they add some traditions and some of their own personal, you know, opinions and taboos, as well as the very what? Commands of God. Okay? Scripture says, what don't people get? You are not under the law, but under grace. What don't you get about that? Could it be any clearer? It'll get clearer. Let's look at Galatians chapter 3. And the reason I'm not under the law, and the reason you're not under the law if you're a Christian, is this. Christ paid the penalty of the law. You broke God's law. You incurred a sin debt. You owed a debt to God's law that had been paid. You break the law in society, you have to go to jail, pay the what? Penalty. The sentence has to be carried out. Well, guess what? We broke God's law, and Jesus bore the sentence so perfectly for us that we have been removed from the sentence of the law forever. We've been removed from the jurisdiction of the law. It has no claim on us ever again. Who the Son has set free is free indeed. This is what it means. Yeah, not under the law, but under what? Grace. God's attitude towards us is always what? Grace, 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 and more grace. We ought to give each other more grace. We ought to give ourselves more grace. That's the challenge, right? To be more gracious to ourselves when we stumble, and to be more gracious to what? Others and their faults and their failures, right? Because God has given us grace that is abounding. Where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. Now go with me, if you will, Galatians 3, let's read. And we'll probably have to close here tonight, but this is a good place to close for tonight. Galatians 3, look at verses, if you will, 10 through 14. Let's read this and comment, and we'll close. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. In other words, if you're going to try to follow the law and by your own works earn God's favor and acceptance, guess what? You're cursed. You say, why? I'm trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to keep the law. True. But the problem is you can't. Look what it says in the rest of the verse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things. Not 90% or 95% or 99.9%. It says all things, 100%, which are written in the book of the law to do them. In other words, if I don't 100% perfectly keep God's law, I'm under the curse. Because God's perfectly righteous. You want to earn your way into heaven by your own righteousness, by keeping the law? You better be as righteous as God. Better be as righteous as Christ. Guess what? You ain't. Ain't nobody ever even come anywhere near. Very shortly after we get out of the womb and start to grow up and have an idea of right and wrong, we start doing wrong. You don't have to teach a child to do wrong. They do that naturally. You got to teach them to do what? Right. That's why raising kids is so hard. We do wrong easy. That comes natural. Doing right, that's a whole other story. Right? All right. But look here. You're cursed if you don't. You want to get to heaven by how good you are? You got to be perfect. So the law curses you.
Not because there's something wrong with the law. No, there's something wrong with you and me. The law's good, we're bad. The law's good, but we can't keep it. We're under the curse, but keep going. Isn't this beautiful, though? Look at verse 11. But that no man is justified, right? Given a legal standing of righteousness by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Look, nobody can, he's basically saying nobody can have a legal standing of righteousness before God. Only those who have what? Faith. Not your works. Keep going. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. You get into legalistic churches, all you hear is about what you must do for God, what you must do for God, what you must do for God. Tithe, read the Bible, pray, don't watch this on television, don't watch television. Depends on where you go. Don't wear this, don't eat that, don't drink this, don't go here, don't go there, don't say this, don't say that. It goes on and on. The list, depending on where you are, the list changes, but it's a big list. It has nothing to do with faith. It's about what you what? Do. It's not, it says, do this and you'll be blessed. The scripture says, believe this and you'll be blessed. There's a difference. Grace says, believe and be blessed. Law says, do and be blessed. Well, I'm going to tell you what. I don't do things that well. I'm going to choose the believing part. Right? Believe and be blessed. Now keep reading. Look at verse 13. Wow, here it is. We've got a dilemma. The law condemns me because I can't keep it. Okay, we're all in the same boat. Christ hath redeemed us. To be redeemed means to be purchased out from. To be redeemed means to be purchased out from by paying a price. To redeem something means to purchase something out from something by paying a price for it. You get the picture? We were purchased out from under the obligation and condemnation of the law by Jesus paying the price of his precious blood. Starting to get the picture? Think about this. And he did it what? Perfectly. So that he removed us from the curse of the law forever. Even though we still, after we believe in him, we're born again, we're saved, we're in Christ, but we still what? Mess up because we're still in this body of flesh. But look here. But we're accepted. We have a standing that's perfect forever. We're in Christ. Look at it. It says, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. In other words, Christ, by dying on the tree, which is a metaphor for the cross, bore the curse. The law said, the wages of sin is what? Death. And Jesus suffered that death on Calvary's cross. And he paid the sin debt, and he purchased us, he redeemed us by paying the price out from under the condemnation of the law, out from the jurisdiction of the law, so that the law has no claim on us today. We are not under any obligation to keep the law to be accepted by God. We are saved and kept by God's pure grace, and we live by not laws, but what? Grace through faith. Keep reading. And we close here. And Jesus did all this that the blessing of Abraham, verse 14, might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through what? Faith. Notice something. The moment you believe, you receive the Spirit. Promise of the Spirit through faith. You don't have to pray and tarry and wait and speak in tongues and have some experience. But something else is said here that's very important. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. He purchased us out from under the law so that I'm not under the law anymore. I don't have to go around trying to dot my I's and cross my T's to be accepted by God. I'm accepted forever, perfectly. I have the righteousness of God, a legal standing before him. In Christ forever, that will never change, that is permanent. It's a gift, okay? And it says that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. What is the blessing of Abraham? I'm going to give you one more verse, just so you get it straight. Don't want to leave you here confused. Go to Genesis chapter 15. The blessing of Abraham is very clear from the Bible.
You know, there's a group of preachers on Christian television today, and Christian television has been taken over mostly, about 90% of it is by these holy roller types, charismatic, Pentecostal, word of faith types, fake healers, tongues talkers, you know, God showed me this, God told me that, send your money, I'll give you this, you know, etc. All these fakers and charlatans. And then you've got those of the Word of Faith movement who say that if you have faith, you can become rich, and that the blessing of Abraham was that Abraham was a rich man. So Jesus died on the cross so that if you believed in him, you could become rich. That is the most satanic, blasphemous, abysmal Bible interpretation I have ever heard. It is twisting the scripture to destruction. The blessing of Abraham is that Abraham was declared righteous by what? Faith. Now, if God chooses to bless you and give you some money, thank him for it. God's under no obligation to make you rich. But I'll tell you what, the moment you believed in him, he gave you the riches of his grace. And you have an eternal inheritance in heaven, which will last forever. The true riches that really count. But look at Genesis 15:6. I'm going to show you this. God made some promises to Abraham, and look what it says about Abraham, verse 6. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for what? Righteousness. What was the blessing of Abraham? God said, look, I'll make you like your descendants are going to be like the sands of the sea. I'm going to give you a land that's they're going to be theirs forever, all right? Israel, right? And he believed. And then the Lord said, well, I'm going to count you righteous. You believed. I'll give you one more. Romans, this is it, I promise. It goes with this, though. You can't go away with this. This is like having dessert. You got to finish it. You had a good meal. Let's not miss dessert. Go to Romans 4. Just two verses. Actually, verses 1 to 5. Let's just read that, and then we'll go. But it goes together. I want you to see this. This completes it. Abraham believed God, and it was counted or reckoned or put to his account as righteous. In other words, Abraham was declared righteous because he believed what God promised. You and I believe in Jesus Christ, we're declared what? Righteous. We're made the righteousness of God. Perfect legal standing before him forever. Look at Romans 4, verses 1 to 5. Here's the blessing of Abraham. It's not being wealthy in this world. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? What did Abraham discover? For if Abraham were justified by works, he had whereof to glory, but not before God. If Abraham was justified by how good he was, he could brag, okay? For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for what? Righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward, not reckoned of grace, but of debt. If you work for something, it's not grace. You work, somebody owes you something for the work you did, right? But that's not grace. Grace means you do no what? Work, and you still get the what? Blessing. Here's grace. The boss says, stay home this week, and just puts a check in your mailbox at the end of the week, right? You didn't earn it, but by grace he gave it to you. You didn't earn it, though. Look at verse 5. But to him that worketh not, but believeth, on him that justifieth, declares righteous, the ungodly, not the good people, the what? The ungodly, the sinners. His faith is counted for what? Righteousness. So there you have it. The blessing of Abraham is being declared righteous by faith. Our last point was this, and don't forget it. Because you are in Christ, you are no longer under the law. You're to live the life of grace. God is not demanding you do this, that, and the other thing for him to accept you. He's accepted you freely. Now, he says, if you do these things and follow my plan, then I can add to your salvation some blessings and some rewards. But that's your choice. But if you choose not to, it still doesn't change the fact that I have given you a gift and a standing before me forever in Christ. Because you have believed upon him. Amen? Let's bow our heads. Father, tonight we're so grateful, so thankful again, Lord, to just be able to have an opportunity to learn and hear these precious, precious truths from your word. And I pray, Lord, that you would take them and, Lord, make them part of our thinking and just to be able to have them dwell deep in our hearts, become part of our soul structure, that we might walk in peace and joy and confidence with you. And Lord, I pray that we'd be able to take these precious truths and share them with others, Lord, to share them with others who are struggling, Lord, who are seeking the truth about your salvation, that we might share these tremendous truths, these principles of the riches of your grace, every spiritual blessing that is ours in Christ. And we dedicate the last moment of the service tonight to anyone here, if you are not saved. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Right now, in the privacy of your own heart and your own mind, between you and God alone, you can tell God, I know that I'm a sinner, but I do believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died for my sins and rose again. And Lord Jesus, I'm trusting you and you alone as my Savior, my Lord. Let's take a moment of silent prayer. Now, Father, tonight, if your Holy Spirit has spoken to anyone's heart, and if they have believed upon the Lord Jesus, my prayer is that you would give them assurance that you have forgiven them and saved them. And, Father, I ask that you'd reveal your love to them in a special way, and I pray that you lead them back to study your word, that they might grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we depart tonight, I pray that you take the written word and make the living word, the Lord Jesus Christ, more real to our hearts and minds. And I ask these things in his name. Amen and amen. Folks, been a pleasure. Have a great night.